And you know to push the red square when you're done. Okay?
Yep, and then I'll bring it to you.
You're good to go.
Thank you, Michael.
You're welcome.
Hello, my name is William Saunders. I'm with Americans United for Life, and I would like to talk to you about our experience here in the United States in our efforts to both protect the life of the unborn and also respond to the needs of the mother. I'm going to talk about the U.S., but obviously our whole effort, and I mean mine and yours, is to build a culture of life. And to build a culture of life, there are many, many steps that are necessary. Not just one or two, but many, many steps. And the situation is obviously quite a bit different depending on what country you happen to live in. For instance, you who live in Latin America have a whole different reality than we have here in United States of America. I'm sitting right now in our office, which is just a block away from the White House, and the Congress is on the other side, probably 8 blocks, 10 blocks away from here. So the reality of what we have to do here in the United States is very different from what you have to do, but we have obviously the same goal of building a culture of life and trying to figure out the most effective way to do that. Now, let me just mention that Americans United for Life is the oldest pro-life, that's the term we use in the United States. I don't know if you use the same term, but pro-life legal or lawyers organization. In other words, it is an organization composed primarily of lawyers. Americans United for Life was founded in 1971. That's a very significant date because it comes before the Supreme Court case that you might have heard of called Roe v. Wade, and there's another opinion decided the same day, which you've probably never heard of, called Doe v. Bolton. Anyway, I'll return to these points several times, but I just want to, the general idea is we're going to look at what's happened in the United States. We're going to look at how Americans United for Life tries to build a culture of life in the United States. And we're going to see if maybe there's some general principles or ideas that we can use in countries outside of the United States as well as in the United States itself. So, as I said, probably the two most important things to understand about abortion in the United States is, number one, most people oppose most abortion. So most Americans would oppose legal abortion in most cases, but not in all cases, but in most cases. So most Americans oppose most United States citizens oppose most abortions, but they don't oppose all abortions. Most do not oppose all abortions. There are certainly significant numbers of people in the United States who oppose all abortions. But in the United States and in other Western countries, for instance, there was just a debate about this in Poland. There's often a feeling that abortion should be permitted in certain circumstances. One of those circumstances is when the life of the mother is at risk, which, if you think about it, is not, I think can easily be argued, is not actually an intended abortion. It's a side effect. But in any case, whatever your view on that is, so in many countries, life of the mother, when the abortion is the consequence of rape or incest. And in places like Poland, where there is a fetal abnormality that I'm not justifying this, I'm simply being descriptive because I don't agree with this, but that is said to be incompatible with life. So, in any case, my point is, in the United States, most people oppose most abortions. Now, this is often distorted in reporting, and I don't know what kind of news you have read about the United States, but it is often distorted because it will be said that most Americans support abortion. That's not true. Most Americans oppose most abortions, but you could argue that about half of Americans would prohibit all abortions and about half of them wouldn't. So the first point, which may not strike you because you may live in a country that is much more pro-life than America. You may live in a country that has much stronger laws than we have in America. And you may live in a country in which the culture is much stronger pro-life than is America. And I hope you do. But just describing the situation in the United States, most of the people oppose most abortions. Second point is that most Americans do not understand what is permitted under the law. This may shock you because you may never have heard this before, but legally, in the United States of America, you can get an abortion, a woman can get an abortion anytime during the pregnancy for essentially any reason, which means there are very few limits on abortion. Now, I want to explain this just a little bit for those of you who are not lawyers and are not experts or have not studied American law, so that you will, I hope that's kind of an amazing statement. You think, how could any country be like that? And you've not probably heard about the United States. So I'll just tell you a little bit about the reason for this. In the United States, we have abortion because of decisions by our Supreme Court. Now, countries in Latin America often have, and in Europe as well, have different systems than we do in the U.S., where you might have a court that's called a constitutional court, you might have a Supreme Administrative Court, but in the United States, we only have one. We have one Supreme Court, which is the final arbiter, the final decider of decisions that come of cases that come through the courts. So, if you had to ask yourself, why does abortion exist in the United States? You would probably say it must say so in their fundamental legal document. Because you would probably say, whatever their basic law is, or there must have been a national law passed that provides for abortion. And I mean, that's a very reasonable thing to say, because where does a right to abortion come from? I mean, we can talk about philosophical and natural law issues, but what we're talking about in this lecture anyway is about the law itself, the law that's in, as we say, it's written in the books, you know, written in a textbook, or not a textbook, but in a law book, or it's entered, you know, it's a written document. And the most important legal document is the Constitution in the United States. It's our fundamental legal document. So, does our Constitution provide for a right to abortion? Does it say that a woman has a right to abortion? The answer is no. The Constitution does not have the word abortion in it anywhere. There's no, the word is not mentioned. So how then can there be a right to abortion? Well, the reason is our Supreme Court said that if you looked at the words that are in the Constitution, you can imply a right to abortion. Now, what words did they look to? We have something that's called the 14th Amendment to the Constitution. So we adopted the Constitution at the beginning, in 1789, and then subsequently during the, many years since, we have amended it 20-something times. So the 14th Amendment says that government, particularly state government, cannot deny anyone of life, liberty, or property without due process of law. That is what is called the due process clause. Now, you may say, well, what does that have to do with abortion? And I agree with you. What does it have to do with abortion? Did anybody who adopted the 14th Amendment intend for it to cover abortion? Did they say in the records of the legislature that they intended it to cover abortion? Is there some official interpretation that came along with the 14th Amendment that it said what certain terms mean? The answer is no. There is nothing. It's no in this sense. Nobody, you cannot find that anybody who voted to adopt the 14th Amendment intended it to cover abortion. But our Supreme Court is not does not think that that is an effective limit to what they can do. And you may have in your country a doctrine which is also in some European countries they have, and we have to some extent here in the United States as well, that's sometimes called living constitution or living tree. The Supreme Court said in another decision, which was issued about a year and a half ago, that those who adopted the 14th Amendment intended for the court to elucidate the meaning of the 14th Amendment as time passed. So to sum up here, it's very important, I think, to note that nobody who adopted the 14th Amendment said what the Supreme Court just said. They did not. Nobody who adopted it said, we want the court to tell us the meaning of the words in this document over time. So, but the Supreme Court has asserted this right. And the particular language that the Supreme Court is referring to, the particular words are liberty. The particular word is liberty. So the 14th Amendment says, no state shall not deprive anyone of life, liberty, or property without due process of law. And the Supreme Court says what liberty means is in another famous decision called Planned Parenthood v. Casey, the Supreme Court says liberty means the right to define the mystery of the meaning of life and the mystery of the universe, which means it's wide open. It's saying that what those who adopted the 14th Amendment intended was for the court to tell us what liberty means, and liberty is a term that is a basic freedom to define the meaning of life and the mystery of the mystery of the universe, the meaning of human life. So, in 1973, and you remember I mentioned AUL was founded in 1971, and it was the first, AUL was the first national lawyers organization in the United States. So it was 2 years before Roe v. Wade, because there were efforts in the states, in the United States, to liberalize abortion laws, liberalize in the sense of making them more permissive, so that it was easier to get abortion, because most states prohibited abortion. And the political process was playing out in the states, in the United States, and I think it's fair to say that the pro-life side was winning. Most states were not liberalizing or making more permissive their abortion laws. They were still prohibiting abortion, most abortions. So the matter was being debated in the legislatures and in public referendums. And then there was a lawsuit. And this is the case that I mentioned called Roe versus Wade. Those are the names of the parties in the lawsuit. And it's the famous case in 1973 in which the United States Supreme Court said that, it's somewhat convoluted, but what it said was liberty in the 14th Amendment included a privacy to have an abortion. And you may say, what's private about abortion? It's not a private matter. It implicates everybody who's present when the abortion takes place. It implicates people who are not present, and it implicates all of society, because it puts at risk innocent lives. But I'm just saying what the United States Supreme Court said was this word liberty included a right to privacy, which included abortion. So most Americans don't know that. And what they don't know that's even more significant is that the same day that Roe v. Wade was decided, the U.S. Supreme Court decided a case called Doe v. Bolton, D-O-E versus Bolton, B-O-L-T-O-N. In that case, The Supreme Court said, in order for, let me change that around, a state could not pass a law which required a woman to get the advice of more than one doctor, and it could not prohibit an abortion on the basis of any reasons, as it says, psychological, familial, etc., that is considered significant by that doctor. So just stop and think about that for a second. Who is the one doctor? It's not the, as in the United States, that you have a family, it's called a family physician or your personal physician who you go to your whole life or most of your life. Who's the one doctor? It's the abortionist. So the Supreme Court said, one doctor. In practice, that's going to mean the abortionist. And any reason that that doctor considers important is significant, is sufficient to justify an abortion. So what that means in practice is any reason. You can say emotional, psychological, familial, any reason. And is it likely that the doctor is going to be persuaded? Of course it is, because the doctor is making money from performing the abortion. So the Supreme Court set up a situation. There was a state in Georgia that had a law that said you had to have two physicians. So one of them would be your family doctor who didn't have a financial interest in the abortion. But the Supreme Court took that out. They said you only have to have one doctor. Since that one doctor is a person who is going to get money from the abortion, and since what the Supreme Court called health reasons are any reason that affects your emotional, psychological, or anything else, then you're going to be able to get an abortion anytime you want to get one. And that's, in fact, this was the situation in to some extent still is in the United States. You can get an abortion anytime for any reason up to birth. So, Americans United for Life are trying to turn that around, to overturn that, to reverse that. So what do we do? Do we consider our functions? Well, you would probably think that lawyers would pass legislation, laws. That makes sense, that lawyers would draft laws that other lawyers in Congress would pass. And you might think, depending on your own legal system, but in many systems, many cases are decided in court. So you might think lawyers litigate or pursue lawsuits. But remember the second of the two things I told you. First, most people oppose most abortions. Second, Americans do not understand what the law is. So the third thing that AUL does that's essential, and I think it's essential whatever country you're in, is to educate. To educate. You have to have citizens who know what the law is in order to get them to support laws, new laws that will change unjust laws. So one of AUL's three chief functions is to educate. As I said, AUL operates in the Congress. It operates in the Supreme Court of the United States. But it also operates, as I was indicating, this may be specific to the United States, but I'm sure you'll get the point, is it operates throughout the government. The U.S. has, you know, so whatever you're going to do to build a culture of life will depend on the legal system that you have to deal with. In the United States, our legal system is composed of, or it is what we call, what at least we in the U.S. call a federal system. So there is a national government, there is, and then there's state governments. So in the United States, we have 50 states. So the federal system says power is divided between the national government and the state governments. And the way the Constitution was written says that unless there's a specific power that's given to the national government, it is retained basically at the state level by the people and through the state. So that's why, if you have studied U.S. history at all, that's why our system is called a system of limited government. When he talks about the national government, it's limited government. I mean, that principle is true in other ways, but particularly it's limited. We have federal government of delegated power. So if the Constitution gave a power to the national government, we sometimes use national and federal as synonymous. So if the national government has this power, it's a delegated power. If it doesn't have a power, then the states would be the place where that power would be, if it exists at all. So in order to try to build a culture of life in the United States, you have to work at multiple levels. Now, our system, the second principle of American Constitution is what we call separation of powers. And again, that'll be, I'm sure you have something similar, which is you have an executive branch. Well, let me turn it around. You have a legislative branch that passes the law. You have an executive branch which executes the law, which puts it into practice, which sees that it's carried out. And you have a judicial branch of government, which is, in the U.S., a limited power. It's not specified in our Constitution, but it's considered to, it was established that, even though it doesn't say in the Constitution, the Supreme Court has judicial review powers, which means it can strike down a law, hold a law unconstitutional if it violates the Constitution. But that was always understood to be a somewhat limited role. It's only been in the last 100 years, or less than 100 years, 70 years, that the Supreme Court has said we don't have such a limited role. So, three separate branches of government, co-equal, legislature, executive, judicial. They're like three pieces on a chessboard or some kind of game board. They're all on the same level. The Constitution, our fundamental legal document, does not say that the courts are above the legislature and the executive. It does not elevate the court, particularly the Supreme Court, above the other branches of government. They're co-equal. Now that's highly significant because that means if this everyone who serves in the executive and serves in the legislature and on the Supreme Court takes an oath to uphold the Constitution. So if one branch of government is acting unconstitutionally, it's the duty of the other branches of government to resist it. Now, I don't know if that sounds surprising to you, but turn it around and you'll see the point. If the legislature is acting unconstitutionally, the court tells the legislature is acting unconstitutionally. So all I'm saying is when the court acts unconstitutionally, the legislature should tell the court it's acting unconstitutionally. This is not something that I can explore in any real detail in this talk. But so one issue is what kind of actions can be taken or should be taken in order to resist unconstitutional actions by the Supreme Court. So again, let's think back. Roe v. Wade, Doe v. Bolton. The Supreme Court says that the people who adopted the 14th Amendment in 1866, I believe, intended for the word liberty to mean an implied privacy right which includes abortion. I personally think that's an absurd argument. Even people who support abortion, one of them, in the law school I went to, Harvard Law School in the United States, there were, of course, many professors who were in favor of abortion. They supported abortion. They thought it was a woman's right, quote, right. But none of them that I recall, and this was many years ago, agreed with the idea that the 14th Amendment gives a right to abortion. So AUL, from the very beginning, has pointed out this, what I've just described to you, and it has published books, which, you know, books which say, which is a symposium of legal scholars, and which look at this issue and examine it from the historical and the legal philosophical perspectives and make it clear what I just said, that there's no way it's not credible to claim that the people who adopted the 14th Amendment and meant for the Supreme Court to tell us it means that adopted the 14th Amendment intended for the Supreme Court to tell us it means abortion. Now, so what is AUL doing when it holds a legal symposium and it invites in very, you know, well-respected, well-known law professors, and it has that symposium? Today, it might live stream it, or it would at least record it and make it available on YouTube. In those days, this was, you know, over 40 years ago, what it did was it collected all these essays and published it. But the point is, AUL is trying to educate. So it's trying to make the correct and clear arguments that anybody who's fair-minded could look at would understand that the Supreme Court has gone way off base, has gone far afield, has is has made a decision that does not make any sense. So that's what we have been doing since Roe v. Wade was adopted by the court. So one thing we're doing, we're having national conferences of legal scholars to examine the issue. We're making that information available to citizens so they understand the situation. So once they understand the situation, though, what can they do? That's where litigation and legislation come in. Now, AUL is involved in all that. So you might say, what is a remedy for Roe v. Wade and Doe v. Bolton? Well, what the Supreme Court said was there's a constitutional right to these, to abortion. So that means that any law that's passed that's directly contrary to that right would be voided by the court. So what AUL and what other pro-life Americans had to do is think about what can we do to restore a pro-life perspective here. And so you have to think strategically, what's the best way to do that? Some of you might say, well, you could pass a law in the Congress, but that wouldn't work because in our system, the Constitution is the supreme, what we call the supreme law of the land. That's what we call the supremacy clause. So it's the supreme law of the land. So if there's an inconsistent national law, that law is struck down. So you couldn't pass a congressional law. I mean, you could pass it, but it wouldn't hold up. It would be voided. So what could you do? You could try to amend the Constitution. And AUL was very involved with efforts to amend the Constitution of the United States. In other words, if the Supreme Court says that we are implying a right to abortion through the liberty interest and the privacy interest in the 14th Amendment, you could pass another amendment, say the 28th Amendment to the Constitution, which says abortion is not a right. You could say abortion, you could say anything you want to. It could say abortion is never permitted in the United States, or it could say nothing in this Constitution shall be understood to provide for an abortion. Or you could say the issue of abortion shall not be decided at the national level. It is left to the states to decide on this issue. And historically, there were different kinds of amendments. So in the United States in the 1980s, there was an effort to pass amendments to the Constitution, some of which would have outlawed all abortions, and some of which would have simply removed the national government from it and left it to individual states to decide. And if you remember what I said a minute ago, in 1971, when AUL was founded, it was up to the individual states to decide whether they permitted abortion. But whichever one of those two approaches you find to be better or to be wiser, what happened in the United States was that the different approaches canceled each other out. Some people who were pro-life supported one of them, some people who were pro-life supported the other one, and the consequence is that no amendment was passed. Now that should highlight for you one of the principles we should always be thinking about when we're trying to build a culture of life, which is we must act prudentially. We must try to make our best judgment over what we can achieve. We'll disagree. Some people would think one of those amendments was more prudential than the other, but the point is we should try to think of what's the most prudential thing to do, because I would suggest for you to consider whether we're better off when nothing goes forward, or we would be better off with people who are pro-life agreeing to some kind of some compromise that they could all support that would reduce, greatly reduce abortions. But in any case, I think nobody wants to do an imprudent thing. You don't want to try to do something that you know will fail. Now, you might argue, well, there's an educational effect in trying to do something that will fail, because it will get it to people's attention. And that's something for you to consider. I think that we should always be trying to act prudentially. And the prudential thing may be to pass a complete ban on abortion. Or the prudential thing might be to not pass a complete ban on abortion in the United States. As I said, most Americans oppose most abortions, but most of America, or half of America or so, or 30-40% of America would support a right to abortion. So could you pass it? Could you ban it? So anyway, that's something for you to consider, something we have to deal with in the United States. So to return to what has happened here in the United States, as I said, we have two levels of government. We have the national level and the state level. So if we were unable to do anything at the national level, we couldn't amend the Constitution and we couldn't pass a federal prohibition on abortion, perhaps we could do something at the state level. And so there, as I mentioned earlier, there's a second abortion case in 1992 called Planned Parenthood v. Casey. And that case modified Roe v. Wade. And what that case said was that, this is very complicated, so I don't want to get into all the details, but it basically said, if a legislature, the complication, the reason people don't understand Roe v. Wade is because Roe v. Wade said that there's three trimesters, and in the first trimester you can't prohibit abortion, in the second and third trimester you can limit abortion, in the second trimester for women's health, and in the third trimester, women's health plus concern for the life of the unborn. However, as I told you a minute ago, Doe v. Bolton means that you can't really limit those things, because it said every law, even in the second trimester or the third trimester, has to provide an exception where the life of the mother is at risk or the health of the mother is at risk. And as I told you a minute ago, health was defined so broadly and left to the abortionist to decide that it's no limit at all. So that was 1973. In 1992, Planned Parenthood v. Casey, the Supreme Court said, what Roe v. Wade really means is that if you don't place a substantial burden on the woman seeking an abortion, you can regulate it in the second and third trimesters. So that's informed AUL's strategy with the states. Let me show you this book, which is available through our webpage and all that, but also, and so it's published, but it's also available electronically. And it's called Defending Life 2016. And what it is a compilation of laws at the state level. So these are suggested laws for states to pass. So let me give you some examples. One of the things we have in here is called, we have laws on the protection of conscience, on assisted suicide, on abortion, and we have some of the laws. So what do I mean by a model law? Well, let's just look at conscience. We have something called the Healthcare Freedom of Conscience Bill, which is a bill that would protect every healthcare provider. If you're a doctor, a nurse, a hospital, an insurance company, from providing abortion, from having to participate in an abortion, or to pay for an abortion. Now, we also have another law called the Pharmacist Freedom of Conscience Act, because one of the issues that's arisen in the United States in the last couple of years is where the pharmacists will be compelled to distribute abortifacient drugs and devices. That's a central issue in a case I'm going to talk about in a few minutes about called the mandate case. So AUL, in all these different areas, developed model laws. Now, I know that some of you or many of you do not speak English, so and this is in English. However, I want to just bring to your attention another thing that AUL has done called Defending the Right to Life, the Human Right to Life in Latin America. And this was a study we did, we worked on, in collaboration with many lawyers in Latin America. And we have a webpage called defendiendovidas.org, and if we don't have right now, we will soon have on that webpage a model conscience protection bill. So you can look at that and you can see the kind of things that we try to do. But what we do in our draft is provide a broad definition of who's a provider, so you have broad protection for conscience. So, Americans United for Life, first, is working at this at the Supreme Court and congressional level. Then it's working at the state level, and it's also working at the international level. And in fact, this whole study is in Spanish, and the webpage is in Spanish, so you can read all about the project in Latin America, which is, like I said, in collaboration with lawyers in Latin America. And I think this is very important for you to understand the importance of Latin America for the whole wide world. Latin America, by which we mean Central and South America, by which I mean Central and South America, is the most pro-life part of the world. Europe is very compromised on abortion, and the U.S. is compromised on abortion, and Canada is compromised on abortion. Lawyers who represent, who are pro-abortion, go into courts around the world, like they did in Colombia in 2006, and they say, in their constitutional court, and they say, although Colombia's constitution says there's a right to life, because of all these international documents, there's actually an international right to life. An international right to abortion. If you will look on our webpage under the legislative guidelines, you'll see that we have suggested legislative guidelines for a legislature in Latin America, in any country, to pass, to make it clear that international treaties do not give a right to abortion. The international treaties never say they give abortion, but the lawyers argue, just like they did in the United States, that other terms in the treaty, if you really understand them, imply a right to abortion. So what they did in Colombia was lawyers came in and they said, look, your constitution may be pro-life, but you signed these international treaties, and these international treaties provide, if you properly understand them, a right to abortion. So they're arguing there's an international kind of right to abortion. And that influenced the court. The court didn't hold exactly that, but it did start to liberalize the abortion in Colombia. And it was in other countries around the world, pro-abortion lawyers come in and they say, you have to understand, they say to the country, whatever your laws are, you have to understand there's a superior law, which is international law, either under a treaty or under the common understanding of nations, which gives a right to abortion. They did that, they made that argument in Europe in a case I was involved in called ABC versus Ireland about six, seven years ago. And they do it all around the world. So the fight to build a culture of life is not parochial. It is not national only. It is not just a USA issue or an Ireland issue or a Latin America issue. There's an international aspect to it. The more Latin America is truly pro-life, the more it makes it impossible for pro-abortion lawyers to say there is a custom to recognize abortion around the world. Just the existence. So beyond what you do in your own country to promote a culture of life, which is fantastic, whatever it is you're doing, whatever you can do, the more you do that, the more you stop the argument being made that there is an international right to abortion. And that argument, the pro-abortion lawyers would take into a national court and say, well, you may have, so they may come to a country in Latin America like they did in Colombia and say, your constitution may be pro-life, but you're bound by these international obligations. So you see how that works, it's dynamic. If you have pro-life laws, then they can't argue not only that their country is not pro-life, if your law says it's pro-life, but they can't go out and argue that internationally your neighbor has to recognize abortion because all the rest of the countries in Latin America recognize abortion. So AUL has always worked internationally, nationally, and at the state level. AUL was very involved in the passage of part of the Irish Constitution, which is pro-life. And we have filed, as I said, we're involved in litigation, filing amicus briefs in the courts around the world, including in Latin America, including in Mexico, and at the Organization of American States, and in the European Court of Human Rights. We file legal briefs. And these legal briefs, for you non-lawyers, is simply an argument in which we look at the facts and the law, and we say, how do you understand the law? So it's called a friend of the court brief. It's a brief in which an argument by lawyers representing somebody, like Americans United for Life, files as a friend of the court to say, the 14th Amendment of the Constitution does not include a right to abortion, because if you look at the history of the thing, nobody intended for it to include abortion, etc. So that's what amicus briefs does, and that's one of the main things that we do in the United States. You remember at the beginning of the lecture, I said that we do three things: education, legislation, litigation. So education, like this book about what the Constitution really means, legislation, so these model laws that states can use, and then litigation, the filing of amicus briefs in courts to say what the court should understand the law to mean. You may be interested, because you may not do this in your country, again, if you're more pro-life than we are in the United States in the existing law, you won't need all these laws. So if you go to our Defendiendo Vitas webpage, you'll see that we don't recommend, generally, as a general proposition, we only recommend, well, there's only a few laws we recommend. The reason for that is because most laws in most countries in Latin America are still basically pro-life, whereas in the United States, the basic law is anti-life. So we're trying to come up with laws that will limit abortion. So these laws, like I was mentioning to you on conscience protection, or on abortion, or on assisted suicide, are intended as a first draft of a state law. So if there's a state in the United States called Virginia, it's just this on the other side of the river from Washington, D.C., it's called Virginia. So as an example, they might want to pass a law on conscience protections for pharmacists. So AUL, they can look this up on the webpage or whatever, and they can get the draft of what we suggest they do, and then they can get in touch with us and we can help them refine it for the states they happen to be in. And that could be done for any state. So it's a dynamic process. Now, you might be thinking, and I'm sure you are, well, what difference does it make if a state limits abortion, since the Supreme Court said in Roe v. Wade there is a right to abortion? And since I said to you that Congress couldn't pass a law on that, that's exactly right. The state of Virginia could not pass a law currently in the United States that banned abortion. You can't do that. But it could pass, we believe, the laws in this book, which would limit abortion in various ways. So, for instance, we have something called the Women's Protection Project. And the Women's Protection Project gathers certain kinds of laws together to help limit abortion as much as we can. Now, so we want to limit it, but we also know that some of the laws will be challenged, there'll be litigation, but we think we can make an argument that the Supreme Court should accept for why these laws are in fact constitutional. So we believe, following Planned Parenthood v. Casey, that the states can limit abortion. So this, now some people would say, well, that what good is that, because these laws don't prohibit abortion. As I told you, the only way to reverse Roe v. Wade is either to amend the Constitution or for the Supreme Court to overrule Roe v. Wade. We hope AUL's legal strategy is that when the court considers some of these state laws, it will eventually understand that it made a mistake in Roe v. Wade, and it will overturn Roe v. Wade. Now, as I said a minute ago, because this is always misrepresented, so if you're interested in the situation in the United States, listen closely to this. What happens if Roe v. Wade is overturned? Is abortion illegal in the United States? The answer is clearly no. Since we have a federal system, if our fundamental document does not address abortion, so Roe v. Wade said our fundamental document did address abortion. So if Roe's overturned, that will mean the Supreme Court says the Constitution does not provide for abortion. That would mean the states would have to decide the issue. Now, of course, the Supreme Court could say, not only were we wrong in Roe v. Wade, but the Constitution prohibits abortion. That would be the best outcome, but it's very unlikely. Because, as I said, given our system in the U.S., if the national level does not address it, it's left to the states. In any case, the point is, there's two prongs to our state strategy. We provide state legislators with model bills they can use to limit the harmful effects of abortion, to limit abortion, to support women, to support pregnancy resource centers, which provide resources for women, to inform women about the risk of abortion, etc. And we hope that will form the basis of a eventual decision through litigation by which the Supreme Court reverses Roe versus Wade. Now, I'm telling you this now because just to give you an example of how we try to advance the culture of life. So we're doing this in the legislators, in the states, and at the end of each legislative year, we issue something called legislative victories, and we discuss what was successful and what wasn't. And the reason we do that is, again, the idea of educating the public and encouraging pro-life people around the world, around the country, that we're moving forward, that things are being done, and also to provide an example of what things are successful in various states. So this is part of the educative function. Now, if you happen to look up these any of our state laws, you'll see that they have titles like, in this part of it, we have the Women's Protection Project. And as part of the Women's Protection Project, we have the Women's Defense Act. And the Women's Defense Act addresses particular issues related to pregnancy, but not all of them. But my point is, why do we call it the Women's Defense Act? Is because we think we have a media communications strategy. So part of what AUL does is not just lawyers. It's also what we call lobbyists, which are people who go into the Congress or into the state legislators and try to convince them that these are good bills or that some other bills are good. We also have communications people, people who think about how do we best persuade our fellow citizens that these are good laws, or that we should limit abortion. I think it's very important to understand that courts do not operate in a vacuum either. I'm convinced personally that one of the reasons the Supreme Court of the United States found a right to abortion was because in the elite culture of the United States, at that time, in 1973, abortion was considered to be something that should be permitted for a number of reasons, some of them for eugenic reasons, and some of them just for maybe more harmless reasons, but it influenced the court, and I think the Supreme Court today is influenced by the attitudes of the public. So part of everything we're trying to do is to help pro-life people continue to express and to press forward on the pro-life cause, and we think that will help the Supreme Court eventually to understand that it made a mistake in Roe v. Wade, that the Constitution does not give a right to abortion. So again, we're operating on multiple levels, and you have to have a media or communication strategy. How do you communicate your message? What words do you use for it? And as I said before about prudence, which particular issues do you talk about? Today in the United States, if we were talking, about conscience protection, this Pharmacist Freedom of Conscience Act would be very important because, as I said, pharmacists are starting to get denied conscience protection in certain states. We have had situations where nurses have been denied conscience protection. So in situations where real people, real identifiable people, are getting denied kind of basic fairness, that's a good, somebody who doesn't know the issue could begin to understand the issue by hearing about somebody who was forced to, you know, they might think, well, abortion, I don't know if I would do it or whatever, but they hear about somebody forced to participate or to dispense abortifacient drugs, they think that's not fair. And it's not fair, and they're right, but that then helps them to understand the broader issue. Another very important general point is you have to be willing, in my opinion, and AUL has been willing, to work in coalitions. So you have to find ways to work with others who don't completely or even very much agree with you, because that makes it more likely that you can pass a law. For instance, just as I was saying, some people might think there's a right to abortion, and they don't understand the law in the U.S., but they might think, well, in the first trimester there should be a limited right to abortion. Of course, we don't agree, but we would want those people to work with us on a pharmacist freedom of conscience or some of these women's protection bills. We have another collection of bills called the Unborn Infants Protection Act, which, so in a situation like ours where abortion is very very wide open, and you're trying to cut back at the edges to eventually cut it back all the way, but you have to start someplace. You know, you have to sometimes work with people who don't agree with you that it should be completely eliminated, but they agree with you it should be partially eliminated, or it should be eliminated in some circumstances. And, you know, and so, of course, in some cases you won't be able to work with them because your prudential judgment will be that it compromises what you want to do in the long term. But I think you have to at least consider these coalition issues to kind of build a culture of life. Another thing or an issue here in the U.S. that I want to talk about for a few minutes, and because in this course about women's health and as well as the life of the unborn, we had, you may be aware of, a health care reform that was passed in 2010, which is sometimes called Obamacare. What you will not be aware of is that law has many aspects that are anti-life. Again, this is complicated and we don't have enough time to go into this in great detail, but one of the great victories that AUL was involved in is a case that was in the U.S. Supreme Court called Harris v. McRae. And the issue in that case was, since the Supreme Court said there's a right to abortion, does that mean that somebody who wants an abortion can insist that the state pay for the abortion, that the government pay for the abortion? And the Supreme Court, we, Americans United for Life, represented legislators who said, no, of course not. Just because it's permissible doesn't mean it has to be funded. And the Supreme Court agreed with us. So many people in the U.S., or some people in the U.S., would think, well, then Obamacare, you don't have to worry about abortion because this law, which is called the Hyde Amendment, which was upheld in Harris v. McRae, said government doesn't have to pay for abortions. So Obamacare can't be requiring government to pay for abortion. But just, this is a technical point, but I hope it illustrates for you what you have to do in a sophisticated way if you're trying to build a culture of life, is that the Obamacare is not subject to the restriction that was upheld in Harris v. McRae. Harris v. McRae and this restriction, which was called the Hyde Amendment, H-Y-D-E Amendment, it only applies to government funding that comes through certain departments of the government. And the reason was because that was the only place anybody thought at the time money would come for abortion. So the Hyde Amendment says if it comes through those departments, it can't be used for abortion. AUL and the Supreme Court then said that Hyde Amendment is constitutional because the government doesn't have to pay for abortions. Obamacare does not come, the funding of Obamacare does not come through those government agencies. Therefore, there is what we call a big loophole, a big opening through which abortion could be funded, possibly in the future, under Obamacare. So AUL has worked to try to close that loophole, and we've had some success in doing that, but not we haven't closed it at all. I mean, we haven't closed it completely. So we support bills in the National Congress that would say the federal government, no money from the national government goes to abortion. That would be permissible under Roe v. Wade and Planned Parenthood v. Casey because it doesn't say, it doesn't eliminate abortion, it just says it wouldn't be paid for. And some people would say, they might say, well, it wasn't intended to have that loophole. I personally think the loophole was intended by some of the people involved in the process. And if not all, but certainly maybe not all, but certainly some of them, and I'll show you and give you an example as I wrap up this lecture. It's something that I mentioned earlier called the mandate litigation. There was a provision in Obamacare that said private insurance should cover, because we don't have socialized medicine, private insurance should cover preventive services for women. And it didn't define what preventive services is. So our Department of Health at the national level said that includes contraceptives, some of which are abortifacients. And the whole litigation, and then there's been a whole series of litigation in the United States about this mandate litigation, because some organizations like American United for Life, which is not a religious organization, we're not religious, we're not certainly not one particular denomination of Christianity or anything. We consider our arguments are logical, reasonable, science-based, open to everybody. So, you know, many people who have supported AUL have been agnostics or they've been of different religions. But anyway, AUL does not want to provide in its insurance covering of abortifacient drugs. Catholic universities, evangelical universities, Jewish universities or whatever don't want to provide for this either. So there's been any litigation in the courts about whether these organizations like AUL, but like a Catholic university or an evangelical university or an evangelical hospital or an evangelical whatever, would institution would have to provide insurance coverage of abortion. So AUL has filed amicus briefs, those friend of the court briefs, 29 times in this litigation. In AUL's history, it's filed amicus briefs over 100 times, but just in this litigation, we filed 29 briefs because this issue is so important, because if organizations are forced to provide insurance coverage for abortifacients in violation of their conscience views or their religious views, then obviously we've lost those rights. So AUL, I mentioned here, we have the model bills at the state. We're involved in litigation. We're involved in trying to pass laws in Congress to provide for conscience protection. We're in the litigation in the courts. We're in the states. We're working internationally for conscience protection as well. And we're trying to do it, as the way I said, both by our legal arguments, but by our public arguments, by the framing of the issues, by the language, exact language we use. So, in conclusion, let me just say a couple of just summary things. To work to build a culture of life is multifaceted. It depends on the situation in your own country, obviously. But generally speaking, I think this idea of education, litigation, legislation is a helpful way to think about it, because citizens have to know what the law is if they're going to change it or if they're going to protect it. And so they may have to pass additional laws, and they may have to challenge laws, or they may have to do other things. And you've got to articulate it with a good media strategy so that you persuade people. And you have to work with others in a coalition so that you can be effective in the legislature and also in the general public. Because if the culture moves in anti-life direction, you can't ensure a culture of life just through the law. The law and the culture work like this. They work together. If the culture changes, the law will eventually change. On the other hand, I think if the laws change, if we start to protect human life and women, then the laws will start to bring the culture back. There'll be a fruitful kind of interaction. But I think it's as important to work in the culture as it is to work in the legislature and in the courts. So I would say AUL's strategy has been, again, working internationally, nationally, and statewide, state level, is to avoid the situation where the perfect is the enemy of the good. Let us accomplish what we can and build on it until we build a culture of life. And if that takes, a law on women's health, a law on conscience protection, if it requires fighting in an international courts, if it's working in coalition with other countries, such as those in Latin America, if it's passing restrictions on the funding of abortion so that it isn't funded by taxpayers, then all those things, and if it's talking about it in public, in the media, through newspaper articles, on blogs, on YouTube, then let's do it, because there's nothing more important than building a culture of life.